Thank you, Jordan and worship team, for leading us in worship this morning. Wasn't that fantastic? And to think about that song we just sang, there's a million reasons to trust him. When he is by our side, there's nothing to fear. What great truths in all of that. Thanks, Dave, for the elder update. Thanks for leading us in that way. We're praying for our elders, and we're grateful for your service to the Lord. Well, happy Father's Day. It's been said that if you want to get to know the core of a person, you ask him or her about his or her relationship with his father. That you can find out a lot about a person through a person telling you about his father, about what he said and how he treated and what he modeled and time spent. And if someone is really transparent, they're often holding back tears, tears of joy because of the love and gratitude and appreciation and respect that they have for their father, or tears of sorrow because of the father wounds that are there and the pain and the hurt. And so I realize when I say happy Father's Day, happy and Father's Day don't always equate with everyone, and happy doesn't always connect to your thinking about your father. But my prayer today is Malachi 4:6, where it says that God will turn the heart of fathers to their children and children to their fathers. And so I pray that today that you would have a meaningful connection with your father if your father's still here on earth. If you are a father here today, I hope that you are going to feel loved and encouraged and appreciated today, even through the message. And if you have a father, maybe your relationship is near or distant, geographically near or distant, but you would make an effort to reach out to your father. May God turn the hearts of fathers to their children and children to their fathers. Well, let's start with this. What is the purpose of fatherhood? That God created fatherhood with an eternal purpose to reveal and represent himself. Just think about that with me. It's not like God's up in heaven and he looks down and he sees earthly fathers and he's like, well, now I should start calling myself Heavenly Father. No, he has eternally existed as the Heavenly Father, and he created us as earthly fathers to represent himself and to show his relationship with his son, Jesus Christ. And so if you are a father here today, you have a God-ordained responsibility to represent God to your family. How are you doing at that? I'm not saying that in a way to guilt you into something. I already, as a dad, feel very inadequate. And whenever it comes to Father's Day, I look and with regret about that I'm not the dad that I want to truly be. And so I'm not trying to heap guilt on you, but how are you doing at that? Have you accepted your God-given responsibility to represent God to your family? Don't neglect it. Don't reject it. Don't deflect your responsibility, but accept your God-given responsibility. Our passage today comes from Joshua. So if you have your Bibles, open them up to the book of Joshua. We're going to be looking at one of the greatest leaders in the Bible, Joshua himself, and he also led his family well. And so we are going to see Joshua and how he led his family and how he challenged his family. And so the message today is going to have a lot of direct application to our dads. The title of this message is Fathers, Choose This Day. But this message isn't just for the fathers who are here today, but it's for anyone who is a follower of Jesus Christ. So turn or point to who this message is for. Point to who this message is for. It's for each and every one of us. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, I believe that God has something for you today. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you as Father, Abba Father. We're grateful that you are the Father even to the fatherless, that you are the perfect Father, that you are steadfast in your love towards us. And God, we thank you that you have revealed yourself to us. You revealed yourself to us through your written word, which we hold today in our hands. You've revealed yourself to us through your living word, your son, Jesus Christ. And so, God, would you speak to us through your spirit today? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're in the book of Joshua. We're in the last chapter of Joshua, Joshua chapter 24. It's actually the last chapter of Joshua's life. He's nearing the finish line. And what he is doing here in Joshua 24 is he's gathering together the Israelites in a very special place called Shechem that we'll talk about later in the message. And he is challenging them to renew their commitment to serve the Lord. And so Joshua challenges the Israelites, and the Israelites respond, and he challenges them again, and then they respond, and he challenges them again, and they respond in return. And so let's role play this together. Why don't you stand? Everybody stand. You are the Israelites, and I am Joshua, and so you respond as Israelites. Joshua begins by saying this, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers have served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And if it's evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your father served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." You're not able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or for your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do harm and consume you after done you good. You are witnesses against yourself that you have chosen to serve the Lord, to serve him. Then put away your foreign gods that are among you and incline your heart to the Lord, the God of Israel. So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day, and he put in place statutes and rules for them at Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law, and he took a large stone and he set it up under the terebinth that was by the sanctuary. And Joshua said to the people, "Behold, this stone shall be a witness against us, for it has heard all the words of the Lord that he has spoken to us. Therefore, it shall be a witness against you, lest you deal falsely with your God." So Joshua sent the people away, every man to his inheritance. Go ahead and have a seat. And as you do, make sure that you have your notes in front of you. Here is point number one. Point number one is choose to serve. Choose to serve. Let's work our way back through this passage verse by verse. Now, therefore is connecting this verse, this section of verses to what Joshua has already done in verses 1 through 13. He has reviewed for the Israelites their ancestry and how God had delivered them from Egypt and provided for them while they were in the wilderness and brought them into the abundant promised land. And so he says to them, now therefore, fear the Lord. Fear the Lord. Have reverence. Have respect. Have awe for the Lord. The Lord, when you see in the Bible, capital L-O-R-D, this is Yahweh God. Fear, respect the Lord and serve him. Obey him. Love him. Live for him. Worship him. Glorify him in sincerity, with authenticity, with a genuineness, not out of obligation, but because you want to, your heart is in it. And in faithfulness, in steadfastness, in perseverance, keeping after it. Put away the gods, small G-O-D-S, put away the gods that your father served beyond the river. When I first read this, I thought that this was the Jordan River because Joshua had led the Israelites over the Jordan River into the promised land. But most scholars think that this is the Euphrates River, and that what Joshua is referring to is the gods that predated Abraham and were in the days of Abraham, the father of the Israelite people. Put away the gods beyond the Euphrates River and then those that were in Egypt and serve the Lord. If you want an exercise this morning, you can take out your pen and circle as many times as you can find the word serve in chapter 24, and you're going to find 16 times. It's a theme. It's an emphasis that Joshua has at the end of his life that he wants the Israelite people to know. He wants them to serve the Lord. Well, we probably don't have in our households carved statues and clay figures that are idols. We don't have household gods like that existed in Joshua's day. But that doesn't mean that we don't have household gods, right? We have idols in America today, right? Do we have idols even in American Christian homes? Yes. Well, let me suggest to you, there's dozens of them. Let me suggest to you a few of them this morning, common household gods. Maybe these gods are in your house. First would be this, the god of materialism. Materialism is an American religion. It's fueled by advertising that says that you need to buy something with money you don't have and something you don't need to impress people that you don't know. And it all comes from our greed and from envy and covetousness, materialism. Another god that we would have is pleasure. If it feels good, do it. That we crave for that insatiable high that is so fleeting of happiness, and we're wanting happiness, and whatever brings me happiness, whatever brings me pleasure, that which I will serve. So materialism and pleasure. What about success? It's okay to have ambition for sure. It's okay to want to go from assistant manager to supervising manager to executive manager. But sometimes we place idols in our titles and they become our gods, the success that we have in the marketplace. And as dads, sometimes we put undue pressure and achievement on our kids and academics and athletics, and we hold that out as something that is superior. What about the god of self? Living for self. Living for self-interest, self-gratification, desires that we want. I want what I want, when I want it, how I want it. We often live for self. And so what Joshua is saying here to the people, he is like, you have a choice in front of you. You can choose these gods, these household gods, these foreign gods, or you can choose to serve the Lord. The same challenge is for us today. Are we going to serve these gods, these household gods, or are we going to serve the Lord? Notice what it says in verse 16. And if it's evil in your eyes, anyone else have a different translation than that? If it's evil in your eyes, verse 15. Some translations say that if it's undesirable, that's the NIV, or disagreeable is the New American Standard Version, or if you refuse to serve, which would be the New Living Translation, that if it's evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose, make a decision. Determine in your mind, be resolved in your heart, choose this day, today, not the next day, not tomorrow, not next week, not someday, choose this day whom you will serve. Whether it's the gods of your father served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. And then Joshua makes this grand statement. But as for me, it begins with a personal decision. But as for me and my house, his personal decision leads to a parental declaration. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The same fork in the road exists today that exists for the Israelite people back in the day of Joshua. Are you going to serve these foreign gods, or are you going to serve the one true living God? Moses said in Deuteronomy 30, he says, I put before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life that you might live. Jesus says, broad is the road that leads to destruction. Narrow is the road that leads to life. It's a fork in the road. It's a decision that we must make. It's a decision that we can't delay. It's a decision that we need to make today. Choose you this day whom you will serve. So who will you serve? Joshua made a personal decision, and then it impacted his family. It influenced his family. Our own spiritual decisions should influence the people that are around us. Doesn't that make sense? And can we guarantee that our husbands, can we guarantee that our wives are going to love and follow the Lord? Can we guarantee that? No, we can't. Can we guarantee that our kids would serve the Lord? We can't guarantee that. Proverbs 22 says, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. It's a proverb. It's a general principle. It's not a promise. And so we can't guarantee those things, but we can live our lives in such a way that would make following God appealing. Or we could live our lives in such a way that we would make our kids, our spouse, our friends, our coworkers not want to follow the Lord. And so I encourage us as dads, I encourage you as a follower of Jesus Christ to demonstrate the superiority of a life lived for the Lord, and to model Christ and to be a positive influence in your family and in your relationships. Choose to serve. Well, why should we serve the Lord? That leads us to the next point. Consider the reason. How many of you are dads of toddlers or preschoolers? You have them in your house right now, okay? Look around. You can see some of the dads with the younger kids. Did you know that the average 4-year-old asks 73 questions in a day? Did you know that? And all the dads that were raising their hand are nodding in agreement and thinking maybe it's a little bit more than even that. And what's the number one question that kids at that age in curiosity ask? It starts with 3 letters. What is it? Why? And they're always asking why. Why? And so I'll be the kid, you be the parent, and you answer these questions. Why is the sky blue? Well, God created it that way, right? Why do I need to go to bed before you? Because you need to get some sleep. I need some time away from you. If we're impatient, because I said so. Why do I need to eat my lima beans? Because you have a very cruel mom. That is cruel and unusual punishment that you would need to eat lima beans. And I hated lima beans as a kid. Well, now let's flip this and let me be the parent and you be the child. Well, Johnny, it's time to brush your teeth. Because it's time to go to bed and you brush your teeth before you go to bed. Because you need to have healthy teeth. Because you need to have healthy teeth to eat your lima beans. And you can see it could go on and on. Well, lots of why questions, and if you're raising toddlers, I'm praying that God will give you patience and wisdom in answering these questions. Sometimes they can be annoying, if we were to be honest, but oftentimes the why question is important. Why is it that we should serve the Lord? It's really interesting to me that the Israelite people knew the reason why. They're the ones who respond to Joshua with the reason why. Notice what they say in verse 16. And the people answered, far be it from us that we should forsake, that we should walk away, that we should abandon the Lord and serve other gods. That's not what we want to do. And then they begin to recount who God is and God's faithfulness to them. It was the Lord who brought us up out of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who did those great signs. You remember the Red Sea? Do you remember the manna, the cloud of pillar by the cloud the pillar of cloud by day and the fire by night. You remember all those great signs that he did for us, and he preserved us all along the way. And all the people through whom we passed, and the Lord drove out for us all those people as we entered into the promised land, the Amorites who lived in the land. And so let me ask you this question here today. The question is this: how has God been at work in your life? What is it that God has done for you and to you and in you and through you? The Israelites started with thinking about their days back in Egypt and how God brought them out of slavery in Egypt. That was the first Passover. You remember the Passover in Exodus chapter 12? That God had raised up Moses to deliver the Israelites from the Egyptian people, and God through Moses brought all these different plagues, the frogs and the flies and the darkness, and then it's the killing of the firstborn. But God provided a better way. God told the Israelites to go find a lamb without blemish and spot, and to sacrifice that lamb and to take the blood of the lamb and to sprinkle it on the doorposts. And so when the Spirit comes, the Spirit will what? Pass over your house and save you. Obviously, it's a foreshadowing of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus Christ, the spotless, unblemished Lamb. The one who knew no sin, who became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus in our place. We owed a penalty that we could not pay, and he paid it for us. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Well, why is it that I should serve the Lord? Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Why should we serve the Lord? Because he saved us. And more than just saving us, hasn't he been faithful to us? Think about the Israelites when they were wandering in the wilderness and how God was even faithful to them during their wilderness years. Think about your life in those seasons of wilderness, of suffering and affliction, those times of hardship. Yet God's steadfastness to you in the midst of that. And then the promised land, how God has fulfilled his promises to you. How can we not want to just serve the Lord? I did a study just recently in the book of Psalms that steadfast love is referred to God 163 times in the book of Psalms. God's love is steadfast, and he is steadfast in his love. Amen. So consider the reason. Why should we serve the Lord? Because God is steadfast. He has saved us. He has been faithful. And so then we can respond like the Israelite people in verse 18, where they say, "We also, Joshua, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." Well, we need to count the cost. And so we'll see this in verse 19. Joshua responds to the people. He says, "You're not able to serve the Lord." How is it that Joshua's going from like this encouragement of them, "You need to serve the Lord," and they're like, "We want to serve the Lord," and then he's like, "You can't serve the Lord." Kind of dejecting, right? Why is it that Joshua is saying this? I don't know. Maybe there's a couple of different reasons. Maybe he's realizing they're not going to put away the foreign gods, and so they're not really going to serve the Lord. Or maybe he's remembering back to their history where their forefather said that we heard the word of the Lord, we're going to do everything written in it. And then like days later, they're worshiping a golden calf again, and how fickle they can be. And maybe he's like that baseball coach who tells the player, you know, that pitcher's throwing fastballs. I don't think you can get up there and hit anything that he's pitching at you. And what does that do to the kid, right? Makes him want to get up there and hit that home run. and driven by that. I don't know exactly why Paul says this, or Joshua says this, but he's trying to help them to see that you can't just say you're going to serve him without really thinking about it. He's driving home a conviction. And he says to them, you can't do this, for God is a holy God, that he is holy other, that he is righteous, that there is none like him. And he is a jealous God. Is our God jealous? Of course he is jealous. Is it right for him to be jealous? Yes. That the Israelite people belong to God, that they were married to God in covenant. It's like a marriage. It would be like a husband and wife, that they should be jealous for the affection of one another and jealously protect that from anything else that would rival that. And that would be true of the Israelites, and it would be true of us, that God is jealous for our affections. And so he's not going to forgive your transgressions. If you continue to live in unrepentant sin, he's not going to forgive you. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he's going to turn and he's going to do you harm and he's going to consume you after having done you good. And so Joshua is saying here, if you don't really put away those idols, eventually you're going to forsake God. And then you're going to experience his discipline and his consequences, and you're going to wind up forfeit the blessing that God has for you. So Joshua is calling them to consider the cost, to count the cost. How many of you have ever dieted before? Anyone been on a diet before? Keep your hand up if you've ever been successful in the diet. You know, most hands go down. But if you ever go on a diet, it's really important that you would count the cost as you go into the diet. Let's say you have a diet that you're trying to lose 10 pounds, and yet you've got this package of Oreos sitting on your counter open. What should you do with the package of Oreos? Well, yeah, of course, like, you eat all of them the day before you go on the diet and then say, I'm going to start the diet tomorrow, right? How many of you have done that before? But you're on the diet, and you leave it out on the counter, right? I might get hungry a few days into this diet. I might need to eat one, or two, or 10. If you're counting the cost of the diet, what do? You take and throw them away. You get them away from you. But sometimes we don't go on a diet because it's the New Year's resolution thing. Sometimes we go on a diet because we go and see a doctor. And the doctor says your blood sugars are way out of whack. Your cholesterol is off the charts high. If you don't go on a diet, you're going to kill yourself. Then at that point, you are not just counting the cost of the diet, you're counting the cost of not going on the diet. So we need to count the cost of what it means to serve the Lord, but we also need to count the cost of what it means to, or what it would be to not serve the Lord. Dads, think about that for yourself. It's not just implications on you, but it's implications on your kids and perhaps future generations. Your kids are learning a lot more about spirituality, not by the things that you say, but by the things that you do, right? A lot more is caught than taught. And so your kids are watching you. Your kids are watching you, how you treat people, including their mom. They're watching how you talk, how you entertain yourself, the things that you watch, the things that you listen to. They're watching what you prioritize. Do you prioritize the Lord? Do you prioritize worship? Our kids are now 18, 16, and 14. This month, via LinkedIn, I was reminded that this is my 14-year anniversary of serving as a pastor of Harvest Bible Chapel. And we moved here when our kids were 4 to an infant, and you think about how fast time has gone. Now as we have an 18-year-old and we're sending them off to college, that What we've done, we've done. And time goes by so quickly. Psalm 90 says that we're to count our days, not count our days like just flipping the calendar pages, but making our days count. Fathers, are we living with intentionality as we're modeling Christ to our kids? It's not just having good intentions, well, I'm going to get around to it sometime, but it's living every day with intentionality of investing into our kids. And so that's part of counting the cost of what it means to serve the Lord, counting the cost of not serving the Lord. But then it comes to confirming our commitment, and we see this in verse 25. Verse 25, it says, so Joshua made a covenant with the people on that day, and he put in place statutes and rules for them at Shechem. Shechem is a special place where God has met with his people. It's actually where he first met with Abraham back when he made a covenant with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. And a few generations later, Jacob, the grandson of Abraham, built an altar to the Lord in Shechem. And in Joshua 8, Joshua gathers together the Israelite people, and he reads the word of the Lord to the people, and the people renew their commitment to the Lord. And so it's this special place that Joshua has gathered them back to. And he says to them, these words I've now written in the book of the law of God. And he took a large stone and he set it up under the terebinth, which was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And Joshua said to the people, behold this stone, a witness stone. Behold, this stone shall be a witness against us, for it has heard all the words of the Lord that he has spoken to us. Therefore, let it be a witness against you, lest you deal falsely, or lest you deny your God. And so Joshua knew that it was important for him to make his commitment known and for them to make their commitment known. To have stones is nothing new in the book of Joshua. This is actually the seventh time where there were like memorial stones. The first one was in Joshua 4 as they're crossing the Jordan River, and they set up these stones of remembrance. And now we have this witness stone. Some archaeologists believe that they have found this large stone that could be the witness stone that Joshua was referring to back then. But he is calling them to confirm their commitment. And there's ways that we as believers, as dads, as moms, as teens, that we can make our commitment known and make it public beyond just something that's inside of our heart, but we declare to others. If you've been around me before, you've probably have seen this stone. This stone is now 10 years old from 2009, and this is the Steiner Shechem stone. And at the top, you see a timeline of when I was born and when I came to know Christ and really when I surrendered my life to the Lord and when Camille and I were married and the names of our kids and their birth dates. And on the front of it, it says, I have no greater joy than my children walk in the truth. And on the back is our verse for today, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. There's also the ancestry, the grandparents that are on the left and the right. And on the bottom, on June 5th, 2009, you can see my sons, Jonathan and Micah, and their signature on this stone. And this stone is a memorial in our house, and it's a testimony in our house of God's faithfulness to us. Maybe as a Father's Day exercise, you want to go out and dig up a stone, or go buy a stone, or do something like this and present a stone to your family. In the New Testament, we see baptism. Scripture teaches believers' baptism. You're not baptized to be saved, but you're saved, and then you're baptized. That Jesus himself was baptized, and he commands us to be baptized, and it's a way for us to confirm our commitment to the Lord. It doesn't save you, but it's a public profession of your faith. On Tuesday night, I went to a men's small group, and I was so blessed by the small group where one of the individuals shared his testimony with the other men in a very transparent way, and it was really powerful for me to hear it and for the other men, but it was also powerful for the individual who was sharing it because he wrote it all down, and he documented that, and what a great story of how God had been at work in his life before Christ and when he came to know Christ and how he's been growing in his life since. And maybe that's something that you can do, Dad, and share your testimony with your family so that they can know that. Another thing is something we do at Act Like Men Palooza. We were just there last weekend. You saw on the screen the highlight video of that. And I'm a big fan of going away with the guys. I'm not a big fan of camping and going to a place without a bed and without a toilet, but we still have a lot of fun. I love digging into each other's lives and into the Word together. But my favorite thing at the Palooza is we do this rite of passage where we invite those who are 15 to 18 years old to come and to make a declaration, and it's a rite of passage. And I'm going to invite some of those sons and their dads to come forward. Ben Smoot and his dad, Dave Smoot, Rowan Thornton and his spiritual dad, Clem Escudero, and Nick Zabran and his dad, Steve Zabran. And I've got a certificate to present to them from the Act Like Men Palooza. And this is the pledge that they made of biblical manhood. Let me read it and then we can affirm them. It says this, that God is my authority. Jesus Christ is my Lord. His Holy Spirit is my guide. The Bible is my blueprint. I will seek with my whole heart to act like a man. I'm not a woman, I'm a man. I'm not an animal, I'm a man. I'm not a child, I'm a man. I embrace the responsibility to be God's man. When I fall, I will run to Christ. When I struggle, I will lean on my brothers. At all times, I will live in community with other Christians, and I will lead my future family to do the same. I will let no one despise me for my youth, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in life, and in purity. The pledge of biblical manhood. Let's affirm these young men and their dads. We're proud of you, men, and we will continue to pray for you in the days ahead. The worship team is coming, and in a moment we're going to close. But let's come back to the title. Let's come back to the theme of this verse. These verses. Fathers, choose this day. Mothers, choose this day. Teens, choose this day. Men, choose this day. Women, choose this day. Choose this day whom you will serve. Perhaps you're here and you've never turned from your sin and embraced Christ by faith for the forgiveness of your sin. Today is the day of salvation. Today, don't let your heart become hardened, but turn to the Lord. Experience his forgiveness, the Passover lamb shed for you. But maybe most of you have already come to faith in Jesus Christ. You have professed your desire to serve the Lord. But if you're like most people, oftentimes we can drift spiritually. Have you ever drifted spiritually? Do you know that if you're traveling somewhere and you're just one degree off, it creates a bit of a distance? If you only go a mile, you're only going to be 19 feet away from where you need to be. But if you're traveling from here to Cleveland on an airplane, you're going to be over 6 miles off course. I don't think any of us want to land in Lake Erie. Take a rocket to the moon, you're going to be over 4,000 miles away, over twice the diameter of the moon. And so sometimes a message like this is an opportunity to remember some commitments that we have previously made and make a course correction. We've just drifted, we've become apathetic, we haven't been on our game as much as we need to do. And so we need to come back. We need to come back to our desire to serve the Lord. I'm going to end with asking dads to stand, not all dads to stand right now, but dads to stand that if you want to, stand with me and to declare with your voice aloud that as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That it can be a public declaration even here in this room. That this is the desire of your heart. And so if you're a dad and this is the desire of your heart, I encourage you to stand with me. And let's let this room be filled with our voices. Here we go, men. As for, we will serve the Lord. Amen. Let's all stand and let's sing together.